So friends, today we start the lectures formally, and as I have given you earlier, the very first lecture, formal lecture, is about classification of goods under the Custom Tariff Act, right? I'm writing on the board. So I suggested you yesterday that everything you have to keep noted, and that will help you to revise the things faster. Material is already with you, but that is for secondary reference. Primary reference will be what you have noted in the class. So the topic is classification of goods under the Custom Tariff Act. Classification of goods. So I hope you remember that yesterday I spoke to you that Customs Act deals with goods only. It does not talk about services. So that's why the title is Classification of Goods under the Customs Tariff Act. Customs Tariff Act, just to give you an idea about this act, complete act can be divided in two parts. First is about the provisions, and the provisions I'll take up later, and other part is schedules. As far as schedules are concerned, there are two schedules. In this process, you will also learn how to make your own notes, right? Notes are never prepared reading the book and copying in the notebook. Notes are always for your reference. Those are either bullet points or those are charts. Okay, never write full description. You should remember that. And I told you that you have to read minimum 3, 4, 5 times before you make the notes. Okay, so if you are preparing the notes on your own, make it sure that these are short and sweet and relevant. So schedules. So schedule number one, this deals with imports, and schedule number two, this deals with exports. Schedule number one, this one is having I'll show you all the chapters. And this one is having 50 articles. Only 50 articles. Here we have 98 chapters, and every chapter is having thousands of articles. That much of difference is there. So we have to focus on schedule number one for understanding the customs, or rather for understanding the classification. Okay, I'll just show you the document. Here we have the Customs Tariff Act. And if I go to the end of this document, this is schedule number one. I'm using the same material what has been given to you. Page number may vary because I keep on changing the spacing, but the contents are 101% same. It will not change at all. Okay. So the page number may vary. Don't bother about the page number. So first schedule. I told you the schedule number one is having 98 chapters. Which are those chapters? This is the list of the chapters. And you are expected to remember this list of chapters. Rashmi ji, how easy it will be to remember?
So basically, being a science student, what I do is I write an abbreviated word or maybe the first letter or which I can correlate very easily with the chapters. And then I, according to my convenience, I make a sentence, I frame a sentence and...
Using good memory techniques. Okay, fantastic. Same is my story also. I am also a science graduate. Okay, next. So this list you have to remember thoroughly because as I told you, this list is relevant for exam as well as for Viva both. Right? In exams, generally 3-4 questions are seen. They give you one article and then they give you the heading number. Identify under which heading it is likely to fall. Okay, so once you know the serial number of the chapter, that itself will help you to identify under which heading it will come. Say, for example, if I take you to chapter number 72, so all steel related goods will come under that category, that is iron and steel. Okay, so that is giving you a broad idea that anything related to steel and iron, whether it is a sheet or it is an ingots or maybe rod or something molded therein, everything will come under chapter number 72. So when the multiple choice questions are there and 3-4 headings are there, any heading starting with number 72, that is directly the answer. Yes, the material will fall under that category if it is related to iron and steel. So that type of questions are there in the exam. And in addition to that, this type of questions are there in the Viva also. Any metal they will give you and they will hand over the physical book to you. That this is the tariff. Now identify under which heading the metal is going to fall. Then it becomes easier. The physical book is with you, right? But if you take too much of time to search the article, then that is something negative. So if you remember that it is under this chapter, directly go into the chapter and identify the product. As fast as you do that, that will increase the possibilities of getting the license. So that's why it is very, very important for you to remember the entire list of these 98 chapters. Okay. Now, what is more important is that in these chapters, what is given therein? So I cannot give you the full schedule, but it is available online. Okay, and you are not supposed to take a printout of that. Never do that because otherwise that is running into thousands of pages. Never take a printout. I'm giving you the site where you can refer that. Okay. So I'm stopping sharing and again it's new share. This is here. Which site it is? Can you see the site? Yeah. Which one it is? cbic.gov.in. Okay. Yeah. cbic.gov.in. In this, go to customs, this portion. Right? You can write down on the paper cbic.gov.in, go to customs, and customs, go to tariff. Right? And when you click on this, this will open, which is already open here. Okay. And then you can see the chapter here, full chapter. Chapter 1, 2, 3, 4, all the chapters are here. Okay. So got the idea where you will get the custom tariff? And this is something on which you will have to apply your, you can say, you can practice little bit that whether you can really classify the goods or not. Take any item randomly, whatever you can see around, and try to find the heading under which it will be covered in the tariff. Because the tariff is already with you. The schedule number one is with you. It is available online. So any article which you can see right now, say, for example, I am seeing this air conditioner fitted herein. split air conditioner, under which heading it will fall, try to find therein. And when you do little bit of practice, it will help you. Now, I'll take you further. I'm again taking you to chapter number 72 because that is important for me to explain you that chapter. This is opening up.
Any easy way to remember all those things?
Which one?
All the chapters, the 98 chapters.
Only chapter heading you are supposed to remember. Entire schedule you cannot. Because more than 10,000 entries are there. How can you think of that? Okay. So this is, these are few notes. And now see something seriously. But this is structure you have to understand. All the entries, how many columns are there? How many columns are there?
Five columns.
Okay. In column number one, what is given therein? Some numbers are there.
Yeah.
Okay. So first number in column number one, that is 7201. So chapter number 72, heading number 01. Got this? Yeah. Right. So, you know, sometime you are given the serial number of the article and then you are required to go to that particular article and see what are the comments there. Then it will help you that what you are referring. So first two digits, that is indicating the chapter number. Okay. Then the next two digits are indicating serial number of the heading. So when you have four digits, this is heading, only heading, nothing else. Right? Now see what is written in the heading. Pig iron and spigen, lesen, pigs, blocks, or other primary forms. Nothing is classified on the basis of heading. Take a note of that. No classification based on heading. Right? Then what is the next entry therein? Next number.
1201 1010
Right, this is 10 again followed by 00.
Yeah.
This is 20 followed by 00.
Yeah.
Okay. So what does it indicate? So this is 8-digit number. This is very common for us. 8-digit classification number. This itself is a question. Classification number, how many digits are there? So this is normally 8-digit and some special cases you will find 10-digit number also. But usually this is 8-digit number. Is this portion clear? As far as numbers are concerned? Okay. Now, here you are seeing in the column number 2, few dashes are there. Right here, if you see, if you look at this, this is only single dash. Right, then here you, this is double dash. Here we have triple dash. Right, and here you also have four dashes. So single dash, double dash, triple dash, quadruple dash. Right. So these dashes also play a very important role. I'll just give you the meaning of that on the board. What is the meaning of dashes? So where do you find the dashes? So just now this was, schedule was on the screen. Where are the dashes?
Second column, sir.
Column number 2. Okay. four dashes are maximum. This is a heading. Single dash means heading. Even if the numbers are more, but if there is a single dash, it will always mean this is heading. And goods are not classified on the basis of heading. Then this is two headings in front of entry. It means it is subheading to this heading. This is subheading. And if the four dashes are there, this is subheading. Okay. Now assume that if I put a heading here, there is some external noise from somebody whose mic is on. Could you please check up? So heading, there will be subheading. I'm writing only SH. Below this, sub further specific further categories will be subheading. And further specification will be subheading. So how far specific we can be there in the classification? It can go up to subheading. Got it? So classification is never based on this. It is either this or this or this. And these are 8-digit numbers. This will be 10-digit number. And 10-digit number is not common. Usually classification is 8-digit number only. Right? This is for exam purpose. Otherwise, finding entry in the tariff, practically, it is very, very easy. That is also available online. India Trade Portal is there. IndiaTradePortal.com. Directly put the name of article and it will show you multiple entries. You can choose there. Okay. So this is for exam purpose that you have to understand. And this is also a little bit about the Viva portion and training portion. So that's why you have to understand how the things are placed and how this classification is done properly. And when you really get deep into the subject, perfect classification makes a big difference. Okay. So got the idea? What is the number of dashes? Once again, I'll take you to that screen where we were talking about. This is here. Okay. So now see. When the single dashes are there, right, these are headings and the classification will not be done on the basis of those. Then we have subheadings. Again, subheadings. These are subheadings. Right. So if you want to prepare a chart, then how the chart will be prepared? Say you want to prepare a chart for Ferroalloys. So this becomes your heading. Then subheadings will be having containing the weight. It is more than 2% of the carbon in other categories. Only two categories. Then another heading, you have ferrosilicon. Then the subheadings are like this. So every time you can prepare number of charts, but the fact remains that not much variation is there as far as the rate of duty is concerned. Everywhere it is almost 15%. Almost everywhere it is 15%. There are few exceptions, but at 22% also and 27% also. Just have a look at this. See here. What are these articles? I also don't understand what are these articles. The rate of duty is 27.5%. The more articles are there, where 22% duty is also there. This is 22%. Okay. So what you're supposed to do it, look for any article around you and try to find entry thereof in that tariff. And if there is a problem, I suggested you go to the indiatradeportal.com. That is the government site. Put the name of article. It will show you number of entry. Then you can come here and see there. You can verify correctness, whether you've done it correctly or not. Okay. So this is about the number of dashes. And in the column number two itself, number of articles are referred. Then in column number three, what is mentioned herein?
Unit measurement.
Unit measurement. Unit for what?
For goods to be imported or exported.
For assessment of duty. Right. So because it at certain places you will find the duty where the rate is given in tons. Say for example, if I stop this and take you to another sharing in the rate of, see here, exporter duty. Okay, so what is given herein? Rate of duty is ₹2,200 per quintal. What is the unit include? What is the unit covered therein? Here it is per quintal. Now see here in the entry number five. What is the unit? Unit is per ton. Okay, so that's how the number of the taxable unit is given therein. For the purpose of tariff, and that is given per kg. So the rate of duty applicable on steel is per kg, right? So then moving further, next is given the percentage given 15%, and the last column number five. What is the column number four and five? So when the percentage sign is given, what is the meaning of that? It says 15%. Right. This 15% of what? When it says percentage, this means this is?
Something assessment value.
Ad valorem duty. This is ad valorem duty. Right. Another duty is called specific duty. Right now, you may not be able to read that. So two types of duties are there. One is ad valorem, another is specific. What are the difference in the two duties? We'll come back to this again. Okay. So now you can see ad valorem and specific. Ad valorem duty is based on value. Value which is determined under section 14. Assessable value is determined under section 14. So if the value goes up, amount of duty also goes up. Value reduced, amount of duty is also reduced. Rate does not change. Right. So if the ad valorem rate is 15%, now you can understand if what is the difference if the value is ₹10,000. What will be the duty? And if the value is 15,000, what will be the duty? Percentage remains same. Rate remains same, right? So ad valorem, when it is given, that is directly related to the value. Value goes up, amount of duty goes up. Value comes down, amount of duty comes down, right? A specific duty, this is quantity based. in this, when the duty is specific, value becomes irrelevant altogether. In this case, value is irrelevant. So whether there is any value or not, whether it is less or more, doesn't make any difference. The duty is based on quantity. That is called specific duty. Right. An example of that, we can see both the things together in schedule number 2. See here. What is given herein for the first entry copy? Which duty it is? Tell me quickly which duty it is.
It is, sir, a specific duty.
First is a specific. Second is?
Again, it is a specific.
Specific, okay. So, first we have some specific duties, right? Up to entry number 11. Now, 11. See entry number 12. What is given therein?
So, 9A is, I think, also adverb.
Correct. 9A is also adverb. Okay. See the entry number 12. Directly, what is mentioned?
Ad valorem duty 15%.
So value going up, amount of duty goes up. Value comes down, amount of duty comes down. Got the difference clearly?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So this I'm showing you schedule number 2 because here it is easy to see both the entry there at the same place. Otherwise, if I take you to the other schedule, that is chapter number 72, it is a long chapter, that is 32 pages are there in that chapter. So you'll have to really look for into the details of where it is ad valorem, where it is specific. 99% that duty is specific, or rather ad valorem. There are very few cases where duty happens to be specific. Got this clear?
Yes, sir.
So any doubt on this one? Specific duty and
ad valorem
duty. Right. So this anywhere in column number 4 or 5, it is mentioned, percentage sign is given. Percentage sign indicates that this is ad valorem. Okay. And if percentage is not there, then certainly the specific duty itself is mentioned therein. Now something more. Here it is. Sorry, wrong sharing. Coming back to it is here. Now in this, see column number 4 and 5. What for these are given? Column number 4 and 5 taken together, that for rate of duty, and this is standard rate, and this is called preferential areas rate, you can say. So two types of rates are there for duty. So now again, I'm coming back to the board. So this portion you have understood clearly. Rate of duty under Schedule 1. Rate of duty under Schedule 1, this is divided in two parts. This is column number 4. This is column number 5. Column number 4 is standard rate, and column number 5 preferential area rate. Two types of rates are there. Standard rates and preferential rates. Standard rate, this is always applicable except where preferential rates are given. And claimed by importer. Standard rate means the rate of duty given under column number 4 is always applicable. Except where two conditions are satisfied. Condition number one, preferential rates are given. Condition number two, it is claimed by the importer. If preferential rate is given, it is not applied automatically. It has to be claimed by the importer. How and when he can claim, that will come here. Under any bilateral agreement,
any
bilateral mutual yes. agreement, any bilateral agreement. The central government may declare any country as most favored nation. Government may declare any country as a most favored nation, or you can say it as a preferred country. Right. This is first. If the goods are imported from this country, then only preferential rates are applicable, provided those are claimed by the importer. That is not automatic again. Even if goods are being imported from this, but not claimed by the importer, duty will be at the standard rate. That's why I told you these are two conditions. First of all, there are preferential rates. Number two, those are claimed by the importer. Right. So, which is the preferred area or which is the preferred nation, which is the most favored nation? So, that is usually referred as MFN. Under the bilateral agreement, the central government may declare some country as a most favored nation or a preferred nation. Same status India is going to enjoy in that country. So when goods are imported from that country, then preferential rates will be applied, provided it is claimed by the importer. Otherwise, duty will be paid on a standard rate. And once duty is paid, no refund. No refund, because you cannot say that I have done the wrong assessment, because assessment is done by you only. You means? As a CHA, as an importer, you're going to do assessment yourself. There are only exceptional situations when the assessment is done by the officer. Otherwise, it is always the self-assessment. Okay. So, first thing is, under any bilateral agreement, the central government may declare any country as the most favored nation. Below that only you have to write. The importer can claim preferential rates if goods are imported from most favored nation. Preferential rates has to be claimed. It is not automatic. and for claiming the preferential rates, which is the main document?
Certificate of origin.
Correct. Certificate of origin is required. Right? You can take a note. So those who are not aware of that, about the topic, you can take a note. The importer will have to produce the certificate of origin. The importer will have to produce a certificate of origin. Right? Now, same thing applies in case of export. As a CHA, you have to work for import and export both. Right? And the countries where India is having the MFN status, they always require certificate of origin along with the other documents. As a CHA, how you can obtain certificate of origin, or how you can, what advice you will give to your client, where from he can obtain certificate of origin? Anyone who is having the idea?
Yeah, what you are asking exactly?
Where from certificate of origin can be obtained? If you are the exporter.
Yeah, certificate of origin can be obtained from chambers of commerce. In case of where the GSP, there are two types of certificate of origin.
Mm-hmm.
Where the generalized system of preferences are there and the normal certificate of origin is there.
Right.
These are the GSP is the generalized system of preferences.
Mm-hmm.
Where it facilitates, the certain countries are listed on the backside of the GSP.
Mm.
Where it facilitate, Indian exporters get a discount. Importer, whatever the is being exported from India and to that country, there the importer get the benefit on producing the GSP.
Correct. Right. So in nutshell, you can say that certificate of origin for in relation to export can be obtained either from Chamber of Commerce or maybe Export Promotion Councils. Okay. So these
certificate of origin in case of export, right?
Beta, tabhi aapko laga rahe hain, if you are importing, then you will get it from your supplier. If you are exporting, then you have to provide the certificate of origin to your customer outside India, so that he can claim that preferential rate in that country. So yeah. Certificate of origin is an important document for importer as well as for export. So the goods are being exported to a country, and if that India enjoys the status of most favored nation in that country, then the importer in that country will always require you to provide a certificate of origin. And actually, the rate of duty applicable in different countries itself is a big criteria for determining what to import, where from to import, or what to export, where to export. So that is also something very, very important when you really go into the deep of the subject import-export. Really go into the practice, then this will be helpful to you to identify the product which enjoy preferential rate and which country. So you can pitch for the sales therein, or you can procure the goods from their country where from India is giving the most favored nation. So for promoting the business of import-export, you will play a very important role. You will advise the number of people that this is the article to be imported, this is the article to be exported, which is a beneficial, etc. A lot many issues are there. Anyway, so this amount, preferential rate of duty has to be?
Sir, suppose I am the importer, then from exporter, I need to collect the certificate of origin.
Correct. You'll have to tell him in the beginning itself that you will require a certificate of origin.
And let's suppose exporter will deny, we will not produce, or I am not able to produce the certificate of origin.
And it is a matter of your choice whether you would like to import that article from that person or not.
Okay.
Right.
Thank you.
And in fact, I tell you that so many times, even specific duties are there, anti-dumping duties are there for articles originating from a specific country. Just to give you an idea, that there are some anti-dumping duties are there on certain articles if those are originating from China.
Yeah.
Specific article, anti-dumping duty, and origin is from?
China.
Right. So there the certificate of origin plays an opposite role.
Yeah.
Right. So anyway, so coming back to this. So preferential rates are also there, but preferential rates are required to be claimed. And for claiming the preferential rate, which is the main document? certificate of origin. Additional information, whatever I've given, that is only for the knowledge, and that may help you somewhere. That certificate of origin, where from it can be obtained, and at the time of export also, you have to provide the certificate of origin to your customer overseas. At the time of import, you must obtain the certificate of origin from your supplier.
Exporter.
Right? Or supplier overseas. Got this clear?
Yes, sir.
So, getting back to this. So, this is what we were talking about. The rates of duties are ad valorem as well as specific. So that we have already seen. And another one in going to schedule number 5. Yeah. Again, came back to the wrong document. So when number of documents are open, this problem is always. Yeah. So here you have in total 5 columns. Column number 1 is giving you the numeric number. Column number 2 is giving you dashes plus description of the article. Column number 3 is giving you assessable unit of the goods. Column number 4 and 5, those are having rates of duties. If column number 5 is blank, it means preferential rates are not applicable in any case. And if the rates are there, then certainly that can be claimed on the production of certificate of origin. Okay. Now that itself was a practical question. At what time you should have the certificate of origin, whether before placing the order or at the time of placing the order or after the goods have been imported. So when you...
Sir, ye preferential rate jo standard rate usse high rehta hoga.
Nahi, kam hai. Kaafi kam
hoga. Hamesha kam hota.
Kam hi honge.
Always.
Sir, always. No? Preferential rate means kam.
Okay.
It is always less than the standard rate.
So one question is there?
Yes, please.
So regarding the classification, the numeric one, just go to the chapter heading. Can you just elaborate on the chapter heading? I mean, this is the 7.2. Let's come to the 7.2 directly.
Yes, this is it.
Chapter 7.2, I mean, the previous page, I mean, where this chapter started. 7.2 is the... I mean, just scroll it. I mean,
see, this is the beginning of the chapter.
This is the beginning of the chapter. So, this 7.2 is this is section based metal. Then, you know, below this chapter 7.2 contains what what chapter 7.2 contains. I mean, suppose it's the question is what chapter 7.2 contains. This is the section, this is the whole section. Now, 7.2 is. I would like to go on the heading first. 7.2 is what?
What do you see on the screen now?
7.2 is iron and steel.
Iron
now and there steel. Iron and steel, it is 7.2. Right. Now there, this is the all the products which are related to iron and steel can be, we can look for that iron and steel there. Now right. 7, iron and steel. Now 7.2, if we just open the 7.2.
This is open.
No, yeah, first half, first one. 7.2. First product. No, 7.2. What is this L, primary material product in granular or powdered form? Now, this is 7.2.0.1.
This is.
Iron steel is 7.2. 7.2.0.1 is 7.2.0.1 is what? Pig iron and what is?
This particular thing has not been given any specific name. This is only the description of the material. You see,
whatever the steel or iron steel products that is in the form of a granular or powdered form will be considered here.
Yeah. So only
to the.
Either granular or powder form.
Other than that, it will not be considered here.
Yeah, other things will not be considered because other chapters are there.
That I understand.
See, but this article
7.2.
Chapter 73, this is articles of iron and steel. So this is only about iron and steel and that one is specific form.
That one is in a specific form, granules and powder form. So whatever is in the powdered form and the granular form, we have to look for this. And this is nothing is given for this primary. chapter is iron steel. What is this L primary, I mean granule? This is the description of that chapter is given.
This is
only... granular. Nothing, nothing given there. Next to 7201 comes for the pig iron and in pigs, blocks or other primary forms. Am I 7201 is there. Now single dasher is there.
Pig iron and the finger in pigs, blocks or the other primary forms.
When the product gets completed within a single dasher and no subheadings are there, as the rest is 00. Am I right? The rest, suppose 720, suppose product gets completed in the four-digit form. Four-digit, is sufficient enough. And the no subheading is there.
No, it will never
subheading be. Is there. No subheading is there.
Yeah.
And then the last digit is 0000. Am I right? I'm asking you.
No. 0000 is not given. So either it is 4-digit or it is 8-digit. So when it comes to 8-digit, certainly some number will be there like this. So it is given 7201 and 10. Right. So you cannot find an entry which is 0000.
Not 0000. 10 is okay.
Yeah.
10, 1020 and why? Last two digit 00 is given. Let us come to the last 8-digit. Suppose a product is classified, is written in an 8-digit form, which we are supposed to write it in an 8-digit form. Suppose last two digits are 00, that it means that that is not further classified into
subheading. Exactly. That is correct.
Subheading is there. Subheading is, there because the heading is there, 7201.
Subheading is there.
7201 10 is subheading.
Subheading, right.
And now, this is not having any subheading. That's why 0000.
That's why 00 is there.
Right.
Got it?
Yes. Yes,
I'm just trying to find whether any preferential rate is there for some article. Because in steel, generally, preferential rates do not apply. Anyway, that was just for a reference. So keep on looking on these chapters as in when you find some time. So entire tariff is available to you here. Okay, on the website of CBIC. Let's take, for example, if I open, say, cotton. So whether we have a preferential rate for reference.
In 78 chapter, preferential rates. Chapter 78.
Chapter 78 is having preferential rates also.
Yes.
Okay, so we'll go to chapter number 78. Yeah, correct. See, reading it theoretically and then seeing it actually, that makes a difference. I don't see in the chapter number 78.
Yes, sir, it's not here, I think.
Anyway, you can always look for various chapters. You can see this in the beginning, initially it is there. Say, for example, you are there for coffee and tea. See this one. In the beginning itself, it is given, it is 100% less 13 paise per kg. Preferential rate. So this is full of this example. Preferential rates are there. Normal rates are there. Preferential rates are there. Right. See this difference here. Paper on the Janus Piper, etc. So this is 70%. This is 62.5%. So this is in this chapter number 9, you clearly find examples where the preferential rates are there and where normal rates are applicable. So got this clear about the structure of the schedule?
Sir, I have one doubt, sir.
Yes, please.
In the case where you told that when we import certain goods from China, some anti-dumping duty is imposed. And if we fail to produce a certificate of origin, what is the fate of anti-dumping duty, sir?
It is presumed that this article is being imported from there. You have to prove it otherwise, that it is not being imported from there.
Okay, sir.
Right. And actually, Customs Department knows very well that which article originates from where. You are aware of the import manifest and export manifest?
It is import report, no, sir, which the person in charge has to give about the vessel.
Right. So that is import manifest, import report. That is a different document for different type of conveyance. So Customs Department is very well aware of which conveyance is coming to India and from where. What has been loaded where from?
So then when the Customs Department is very well aware, then why is it necessary for us to produce certificate of origin in case of preferential rate of duty?
They are aware of, but the document are required. Now you see, even if the articles are being imported from China, quite possible the goods are manufactured in South Korea. Therefrom those have gone to China, and from China that is coming to India. That is also possible. So certificate of origin will say that it is from South Korea, not from China. So then that anti-dumping duty, which is applicable for the goods originating from China, that will not be applicable.
Okay.
So that's why documents are very important.
Sir, in case of preferential rates of duty, as you talked about the most favored nations, that is given in the notification from these nations, this preferential duty will be applicable. That is covered through a notification. Otherwise, correct. From all the nations, it is not. Through a notification?
It is not. Right? So, some other day, I will take you to the portal, India Trade Portal. And I will tell you how to identify which product from which country and what kind of agreements are there and what kind of rates will be applicable.
Well, that's what I am asking you. That is subject to agreement, bilateral agreements. Or multilateral agreements, or where the India gives a subsidy to a certain nations, that is the most favored nations, as you talked about, that preferential rates of duties are applicable, and it is advised or it is brought to the public through a notification and through the other. It is not for all the countries.
No, never. Otherwise, the purpose of giving the standard rate and preferential rate is lost. Isn't it? So the preferential rates are available only if the goods are originating from the country which has been designated by the central government as the most favored nation. Otherwise, it is not applicable. Okay. Now, in relation to that only, I'll show you something more. What is section 4? Levy of duty where a standard rate and preferential rates are specified. Yeah, we'll go to section 4. This entire act we have to study. Okay, this is the just relevant.
How many sections are there? How many sections are there in this custom tariff?
13. Okay, so section 4 we are talking about levy of duty where a standard and preferential rates are specified. So this is where, in respect of any article, a preferential rate of revenue duty is specified in first schedule or admissible by virtue of a notification under section 25 of the Customs Act. So what is section 25 of the Customs Act? This is power to grant exemption. So exemption can be partial also. That is another way of giving the exemption. But when it is an exemption, then preferential rates are not there and the duty is actual, but some discounts are offered thereof. The duty to be levied and collected shall be standard rate, and unless the owner of the article claims at the time of importation that it is chargeable with the preferential rate, being the producer or manufacturer of such preferential area as is notified under subsection 3, the article is determined in accordance with the subsection 2 to be such produce or manufacturer. What did you get from this? I think this all I have already explained to you.
When yes. But then finally, the importer has to claim it.
Importer has to claim it. And how he has to claim, that also I have given you.
Yeah, certificate.
Through the certificate of origin. Okay. Now, the central government may, by notification, the official gazette, make rule for determining the article as a producer or manufacturer of any preferential area. So, government has already framed the rule for certificate of origin, and those are standard origin, standard document. Now, are you aware of any organization which is governing the international business? Which is that organization which is governing the international business by all the multinational or bilateral agreements?
WTO.
WTO, World Trade Organization. And there is World Custom Organization is also there.
Yeah, but WCO.
So WCO is for the government part. Right. So how the government functioning should be there and what kind of rules and regulations should be framed, that is governed by WCO. And how the business should be carried on, how the business can be smoothened, that is governed by this World Trade Organization, which is the most common document, or which is the most common thing which is issued by WTO, which is always required in international business. What is that? Any idea? The most common document which is issued by the WTO and it is referred in international business on a regular basis.
No, sir.
Have you heard this name?
No, sir.
No? नोट करो मुझे याद दिलाना इस पे मैंने लेक्चर लेना है मैं तो भूल गया था लिस्ट में ऐड करना
यस यस वी अंडरस्टूड सर
है ना
सवाल सही
दिस इज इशूड बाय आईसीसी नो
हम
दिस इज दिस आर एडवाइज्ड बाय आईसीसी इंटरनेशनल चैंबर ऑफ कॉमर्स
इंटरनेशनल चैंबर ऑफ कॉमर्स बट दैट इज प्राइमरीली डब्ल्यूटीओ देन आईसीसी एनीवे सो दिस स्टैंड्स फॉर इंटरनेशनल commercial terms where from the word originates Incoterms right aaj aapke liye homework some homework for you see at least two videos on Incoterms on YouTube today In any case, I'm going to explain you everything, right? And right now, I'll give you a brief of this. But two videos may not be more than 15 minutes each, but two videos must be seen today on Incoterms. That is your homework for the day. Noted?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Now, Incoterms, these talk about only place of delivery where the goods shall be delivered and this implies who will have risk of loss up to which place delivery means what when you buy the goods from a shop The delivery is given to you at the shop itself. The moment you come out of the shop and the goods are destroyed, the shopkeeper is not responsible. When the goods are bought by you on the basis of home delivery, until goods are brought to your doorstep, the responsibility or the risk of loss is of the seller. Right? So this, all these Incoterms are determine the place of delivery, the risk of loss, Actually, this is only the thing. And who is going to incur the cost in relation to what? Everything is determined as per Incoterms. Right. So this is a complete topic. One full lecture will be required at least for covering the Incoterms, maybe more than that. But today, when you go through the videos, you will understand lots of things. Okay?
Okay, sir.
Now, coming to the rules of interpretation, rules of interpretation. And these rules only applies for schedule number one. Of course, what is there in schedule number one that automatically applies to schedule number two? So where these rules are given? Where these rules are given?
Below the schedule.
These rules are a part of schedule number one. These rules are a part of schedule number one. This is here. So first schedule, import tariff, section number two, and general rules for interpretation of the schedule. This is in relation to classification of goods in the schedule, shall be governed by the following principle. So for the purpose of classification, these rules are absolutely necessary. Without understanding the rules, practically it will be difficult for you to classify the goods. So just to give you the brief of the class, these rules, in total there are six rules. In total, these are six rules. Rule number one. Take a note what I'm writing on the board. Read it slowly and you will understand that. Rule number one says, chapter title and headings are not the part of law. These are given therein, but not considered as a law. So when something is not a law, can you base the classification on that? Therefore, no classification.
Chapter
title as well as headings. These are not the part of law. So no classification on the basis of these. The classification shall be based on subheading, sub-subheading, sub-sub-subheading, and description given therein. Therein. This is rule number one in a simplified language. Is it noted?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Now read this. Rule number one. This is the title of section. Which section? In schedule itself, number of sections are there. Chapters, subchapters are provided for the ease of reference only. In other words, they are saying these are not the part of law. For legal purposes, classification can be determined only on the basis of headings, sorry, this I've taken something wrong. Chapter title and section, please replace the word. Section, okay, because heading is coming here. Provided for the ease of reference, the legal purpose, classification shall be determined according to the terms of heading and not any relative section or chapter notes, provided such headings or notes do not otherwise require according to the following provision. So, rule number one is general rule. It's saying the classification shall be based on either heading or subheading or subheading, etc., or the description given therein. But don't do the classification on the basis of chapter or section title. I'm replacing the word section. I hope you have done the correction. Is it done?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Good. Okay. So that was a small error on my part. So chapter and section title. Which section? Schedule itself is divided into multiple sections. So chapter, or rather no classification on the basis of chapter. What was the title of the chapter? Chapter 72, Iron and Steel. So everything which is produced with the manufacturer or manufactured with iron or steel will not come under chapter number 72. Because you've already seen the next chapter heading also 73. What is the heading of the chapter number 73?
Articles of iron and steel.
Articles of iron and steel, right. So you do not go on the basis of the chapter or section title. Go into more details. So it should be based on the heading, subheading, subheading, etc., and the description given therein. Unless some other details are given. So unless otherwise given means we'll refer to rule number 2 and rule number 3. Now I'll take you to rule number 2. What is there in rule number 2?
Rule number one, there's one question.
Yes, please.
So section heading, chapter heading, subchapter heading is not the part of the law.
Right.
But section notes or chapter notes.
Those are for interpretation. Those are always required to be referred.
Now that is a part of law, no? That is
yes. Only thing is these titles, omit these titles, nothing else. Okay. So we cannot rely on the title. Whatever description is given, whatever explanatory notes are given, those are meant for the assistance and those are the part of law. These are called rules. But rules, where these rules are given? Tell me where the rules are given. Rashmi ji, aapki awaaz nahi aa rahi, aap kuch bol rahe the.
Rules. On the top of the, the first schedule.
Schedule is a part of
Custom Tariff Act.
Custom Tariff Act. Custom Tariff Act is a law, and the part of that will automatically be a law.
Right.
Isn't it? Though these are called rules, but actually that is a law. Right. Now that itself was a question when the exam was descriptive, whether these rules of classification have any legal force. And the answer was this much only. Though these are called rules of interpretation, these are contained under schedule number 1 of the Customs Tariff Act, and the schedule is a part of the Custom Tariff Act. Custom Tariff Act being a law, and every part of thereof is automatically a law. Got it? So these are called rules, but actually those are laws. So unless the need is there, how come need will arise? That you'll understand immediately when we come to rule number 2. The classification ends in rule number 1 itself. Right. When rule number 2 becomes applicable, specific situations are given. So when any article is coming in that, then you'll have to refer rule number 2. In rule number 2, two parts are there. Practically, these are referred as rule 2A and 2B. Actually, these are not rule 2A and 2B. Actually, these are rule 2, clause A, rule 2, clause B. This is applicable for incomplete, unfinished article. incomplete or unfinished article. This is also applicable for goods imported in CKD, SKD condition. What is CKD, SKD?
Semi knockdown
and
complete knockdown.
Complete knockdown. What are the simple words? CKD, SKD, those are used commonly in the legally. What are the simplest words for?
Dismantled,
partially dismantled or disassembled. Right. So partially disassembled, it means it is SKD, semi knockdown. Fully disassembled, that is CKD, completely knocked down. Right. So when goods are either incomplete or unfinished and goods are imported in CKD or SKD, what shall be the classification? Rule number 2, clause number A says, even if goods are being imported in this condition, but if the essential characteristic remains same, why these are imported this way? Why will anybody import the goods in CKD, SKD condition?
Because the cost of the cost of mantling there, as in putting everything together, might be very high.
Reduce import duty.
Okay, I'll
make it compact.
I'll give you that is certainly. I'll give you one small example that will immediately help you to understand. When you see a ceiling fan, right? How it is sold in the market?
In parts,
right? So it is sold in a small pack, 1 foot by 1 foot. This will have the main rotor plus the main rod plus electrical gadget like the regulator, etc. And another separate packing that is having only blades. Have you seen that? Sabine dekha?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
And almost everyone. Now imagine a situation if the fan is sold fully assembled, what will happen?
Yeah, logistic reasons. I mean, it will occupy more space and difficult to carry.
Carry, lots of extra cost, lots of transportation issues, and the price of one ceiling fan will be equal to the cost of the air conditioner. Isn't it? That is one reason. So when you import the goods in CKD, SKD condition, the value is also on the lower side. And when the value is on the lower side, the duty automatically goes low. Which is the most luxury vehicle which is imported and assembled in India?
Luxury vehicle.
Anybody from Pune here? Anybody from Pune? Except me.
Range Rover.
Mercedes is assembled in Pune. Right? It is imported in CKD condition and it is assembled in Pune. Why? Same reason. If you import the assembled car, the logistic itself is very expensive and other things are involved. When it is imported in CKD condition, in 10 containers, 20 cars are imported. Otherwise, one container, one car. Huge difference will be there. So anyway, so coming here, incomplete or unfinished article, CKD, SKD article, how these should be classified? The question is whether these articles and finished or complete articles are having the same characteristics or not. Most important characteristic, whether it is same or not. Right. If you go to a shop and see a mobile, they also have a dummy mobile phone.
Yes, sir.
Right. Dummy mobile phone will have maybe the exactly same physical appearance as the original phone. Right. But does it have the essential characteristics same?
No.
No.
It is not. One is a toy, another is a mobile phone. Right. What rule 2A is saying, if the goods are in this condition, but if the essential characteristics are same, the classification will be same as those of finished or complete goods. If essential characteristic of these goods and those of complete or finished goods are same, then classification will also be same. Classification will also be same. Now apply this logic and see how many articles are sold in the market in CKD, SKD condition. Think of one example. Everybody has to give one example so that lots of examples are available to everyone. When the goods are sold in CKD, SKD in the market.
Sir, double cots are sold in CKD condition, sir.
Which one?
Double cots. Cot.
Cots, right. Next.
Air conditioners, any kind of furniture.
Any kind of furniture.
No. Like big furniture, sir. Like
big furniture, right?
Computer set. Computers.
Computers, yes. Specifically.
TVs also.
Even televisions also sometimes those are sold in
CKD. All the parts are.
All the parts are coming separately, then those are assembled at home.
LCD and panels are different parts.
More simple examples. A food processor used in the kitchen.
Mixer. Grinder.
Grinder. How it is sold? Right? You have to think everywhere you will find this example. That goods are being sold in a disassembled or CKD, SKD condition. So when those are imported goods, again the same thing applies. Right? Anybody has purchased araldite at any time? Araldite, yes, is an adhesive. Araldite.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
They are the tubes are there? Two tubes are there, sir.
Why those are two tubes?
They are the semi formats which we are connected and then it becomes
the moment you mix those, right? As long as those are separate, that is not those are not the adhesives, right? The moment you mix, it becomes an adhesive.
Yes.
And the life is 5 minutes.
Fine.
Right. So if it is sold in mixed condition, can it be sold? It
no.
cannot be. That is another reason for goods being removed or goods being sold in CKD, SKD condition. Right. Hair color. How the hair color is sold? Again, a combination of 2-3 things. You have to mix and then apply it. Isn't it? So many examples are there which will come under this category. Any more example you would like to quote? Anyway, rule number 2B, I'm not taking right now because that is again a subject matter of discussion. So what we have learned today, then I'll teach you some things altogether different. What we have learned today, you structure of the schedule, types of duties, where those are applicable, and a few rules. How long it will take you to revise? Rashmi ji, after a long gap, how long it will take you to revise? आवाज नहीं, आप म्यूट पर हैं।
5 minutes sir.
5 minutes, yes. उससे ज़्यादा time चाहिए नहीं. See, any lecture revision will be 5 to 10 minutes max. And again, I'll give you the same suggestion every day. As soon as the lecture is over, make it sure you don't move away. Spend 5 more minutes, revise it 3 times at least, and then go away. Okay. Now I'm taking you to all together something different, and that is my hobby. I always, always do that. What are you seeing here?
PowerPoint.
What is written?
How to become the best version of yourself.
How to become the best version of yourself. Okay. So everybody has got the unlimited potential to grow, but somehow who has spoiled our potential?
Ourselves.
Who has helped us to spoil this entire courage that we had in the beginning?
People around us.
No, sir. It's conditioning of our own mind.
Our schools. Right.
Yes.
Motivation is also required, sir.
अरे मोटिवेशन तो गया एक तरफ, उन्होंने तो हमको सत्यानाश कर दिया, जो मोटिवेशन था वो भी खत्म कर दिया. Isn't it? We have been trained to be a memory machine. Actually, the talent is something different. So I'll give you some tips how to change yourself, right? So you were created with the unlimited potentials, you were created limitless. There is nothing that you cannot achieve, nothing. This is only a mindset that I can do this and I cannot do that. Do you have any idea, or you can list down 5 things which you think you cannot do? Question to you. Note down on paper 5 things which you think you cannot do. It is your homework. You don't have to do it now. Just put a title. I cannot do. And write down 5 things there. And that is your homework. Right. Next is, only you hold the key to unlock your own potential. And I can help you to realize your that potential. I cannot change that. Potential is where? Potential is in you. And I can help you to open, or you can say unleash that potential. But for unleashing, I am giving you 2 questions. First question. This question also you have to write an answer.
Slide is not moving, I think.
Slide is?
Not moving.
No, this must be net issue. I move to the next slide.
Slideshow is not working, sir.
Yes, sir. Actually, we are seeing only first slide.
Okay, just a minute. Once again, we'll go to the sharing and...
Yes, sir. Now I can see it.
Now we have question number 1. To what extent you are governed by external circumstances like the place or people or event or environment or light or sound or weather? How these conditions affect you? So many people you will find that I'm comfortable in the office, I'm not comfortable while going out in the market, I'm comfortable with this person, I'm not comfortable with that person. I like this kind of event. I don't like that kind of event. How far you are affected by these things? Right? You have to think. I'm giving you a question to think over. How come or to what extent you are affected by these external things? Next question. You are governed by emotions or by logical mind? What governs you, logic or emotion? In the family, who's more logical, who's more emotional? Raviji. Who's more emotional, who's logical?
More emotional.
All these questions are homework.
You have to think on these questions. I'm just guiding you. You have to think, find an answer. And when you have the answer, I'll take you further.
Yeah, I think, answer.
In the family, you will find the head of the family is logical and all mothers are emotional.
Very true.
Right. So the children know how to blackmail and to wound them. Right. So if you come out of the emotions, the chances of improvement are always there. Now, inner strength. So some keys, what to do. First is, be strong inside. Don't allow any person or anything to control you. In the traffic, what happens? When you're on the road, people are driving irrationally, irresponsibly. What happens? You get irritated or not? Just think of it, whether you get irritated or not.
Yes, sir.
Almost everyone, right?
Yes.
And if you are going for some very important task, some very important activity, and you reach their destination and you are fully irritated, what will happen? What will happen? I said something very important. Right? Quite possible the purpose for which you have gone is totally lost only because you are irritated. Can you learn to control that irritation? Or not? Number two, take decisions based on logic. Don't flow with the emotions. Why not to flow with the emotions? Reason I have given you therein. Only a dead fish flows with the emotion, flows with the flow of water. If the fish is live, it will never go in the direction where the river is flowing. If the fish is dead, it will flow with the flow of water. So you have to decide whether you want to act as a dead or you want to act as a live person. So if you are live, go logically. Don't go by emotion. By chance, if the logic and emotions are same, good enough. No problems. But do not be governed only by emotions. Last two words. Have a firm decision to be consistent. And take a decision not to stop until you get the goal that you want. Because there is no value for the efforts. Value is only for the result. And all those chartered accountants who are well present here, they understand the difference between 199 and 200. What happens in CA final if you get 199? What if it is 200? Any difference?
Lot of.
Quite possible the person who scored 199, he has put in more effort than the person who scored a 200. Right. But ultimately, what is going to happen? What is the end result? End result is the person scoring 200 is passed, 199 is failed. So he has to write all the papers once again. Efforts are never valued, and this is one of the reasons for irritation for number of people, that I have done so much of efforts and still there is nothing. Nobody values your efforts. What is valued is result. Okay, so in this exam also, what will matter?
Results.
How many hours you studied, nobody is going to ask you. Whether you studied 1 hour or 10 hours a day, doesn't make any difference. If you get the result positive, everything is valid. If the result is not positive, everything becomes useless. Right or wrong?
Definitely, sir.
Right. So you have to keep on working for the result that you want. Never leave anything for chance. Never ever leave anything for chance. Always be prepared. Always be prepared. Assume that tomorrow I give you a test on the topic which I have covered today. You should be ready. You cannot tell me that, sir, you did not tell us about that test in advance, so we have not prepared. Never. Prepare yourself on daily basis. And your revision always starts from page number one. Revision doesn't mean only today. Whatever we did yesterday, maybe you have taken the note only 2 pages. Revise that today also. And today's material minimum 3 times before you leave the seat. Right. So that is the way of learning. Nobody is going to teach you how to learn, but I will make it sure I'll teach you how to learn. That is your bonus. Okay. So with this, we'll end the session today. Tomorrow we'll continue with the rules, and we'll also talk about all the sections under the Custom Tariff Act. So till then, thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Good night, sir. Nice.
Good night.